मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी, आई एम मानिक शर्मा फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड एप्लीकेशंस, डीएवी यूनिवर्सिटी जालंधर. सो इट्स माय इमेंस प्लेजर टू इंटरेक्ट विद सच ए वंडरफुल ऑडियंस लाइक यू. सो टुडे आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू टीच यू समथिंग or to explain you something. Rather, I am going to share some of the concepts, some of the thoughts related to the need of smart diagnostic framework for human psychiatric disorders. So we will share the different concepts, the different facts related to this concept, that is need of smart diagnostic framework for human psychiatric disorders. So the main objective of this presentation are, so to briefly describe the stress and stress-based human psychological disorders, to present the disease diagnostic system, to define machine learning, its technique and their applications, to highlight the nature-inspired computing techniques, to briefly accentuate Internet of Things, IoT, its size, coverage, as well as its growth, to highlight the concept of context-aware computing. So, in brief, so during this presentation, we'll try to highlight the need of smart and intelligent healthcare diagnostic application used for psychologically disordered patients. So before moving to the actual content, let us first understand what is a human disease and what are the different human disorders. So human disease is an impairment of the normal state of human being that interrupt or modify the major functionings of the human body. You know, it's very difficult to define the term disorder or the term disease. The definition of illness and disease found to be very complex, despite the fact that these terms are often used interchangeably. Illness is not equated with a disease. So a person may have a disease for many years without even being aware of its presence. So although diseased, this person is not ill. Similarly, a person with diabetes who has received adequate insulin treatment obviously is not in the category of the ill person. Likewise, an individual who has a cancer is often totally unaware of having the disorder and is not ill until after many years of growth of the tumor, during which time it has caused no symptoms. So ultimately, what is a disease? It can be defined at the simplest level as any deviation from normal form and function. It may either be associated with illness or be latent. So in the later circumstances, the disease will either become apparent at some later time or will render the individual more susceptible to the illness. So the person who fractures an ankle has an injury, a disease, producing immediate illness. So both form and function have been impaired. So at a very core level, we can simply state that any deviation from the threshold value of for the physical fitness can be defined as a disease. So, or in other words, we can say that any deviation from normal form and function may be trivial if the deviation is minimal. So there are different kind of human disorder. You know, nowadays we are suffering from a wide sphere of human disorders. So these disorders may be categorized into different categories, into different types. So some of the important kind of categories related to human disorders are congenital diseases. Now, what is congenital diseases? Congenital diseases means a birth defect. A birth defect, also known as congenital disorder, is a kind of condition, is a condition present at birth regardless of its cause. So birth defect may result in a disability that may be physical, it may be intellectual, or it can be a developmental. So the disability can range from mild to severe. Birth defects are divided into two main types. So one is the structural birth disorder, and second is the functional birth disorders. So cleft lip, spina bifida. So these are kind of congenital diseases which are normally associated with the birth disorders. Second, acquired diseases. In acquired diseases, so we have two different kind of human disorders. So one is a communicable disorder, and the second is a non-communicable disorder. Now, what is a communicable disorder? So a communicable disorder means a disease that occurs due to some communication. So the communication, it can be your handshaking, it can be any physical communication, or it can be airborne, etc. So some of the communicable diseases are cholera, malaria, TB, typhoid, and we are suffering from the pandemic, that is COVID-19, which is a category, which is a type of communicable human disorder. So likewise, we know that HIV is also a communicable human disorder. So despite communicable human disorders, a human being also suffers from a wide varieties of non-communicable disorders, like cardio problems, the problems related with immunity, the psychological disorders that affects the state or the mental state of the human being, neurological disorders, cancer, kidney, and lung disorders. So let us first understand in this presentation what we want to do. We want to focus on the human psychological disorder. So what is the human psychological disorder? So a disease, a problem that affects the psychology of the human being is known as human psychological disorder. And stress is one of the most dominant kind of human psychological disorder, which is affecting a very massive number of people across the globe. So what is exactly stress? So it's very difficult to define stress, because it cannot be measured in kg, it cannot be measured in meters. We do not have an exact operators and an exact measurement for this kind of human psychological disorder. Though certain parameters, certain metrics have been defined for the measurement of the stress, but they are not a real kind of metrics. So what is exactly stress? So stress is a kind of a feeling of emotional or physical tension. Basically, it is a kind of a feeling. You know, we can, this is a hybrid consolidation. It is defined as consolidation of a physical, behavioral, and psychological reaction. Stress can come from any event or thought that make you feel frustrated, angry, or nervous. Stress is your body reaction to a challenge or a demand. In short, stress can be positive, such as when it helps you avoid danger or meet a deadline. So, a kind of stress is required to achieve certain goals. So, because if we do not take stress, we cannot meet the deadline. So it means a kind of volume, a volume of stress is required to achieve specific goals. But beyond a threshold value, it may take a form of human disease. It will affect emotionally, it will affect mentally, it will affect physically. It will, you know, from this diagram, we are able to, from this diagram, if you are able to see, stress is affecting the home, it is affecting the economy, the financial position, the love life, the married life, as well as the business. So home, income, family, love, business, all these are significantly affected by this kind of human psychological disorder. So therefore, it becomes mandatory to understand, to recognize, to diagnose this human psychological disorder at an early stage so that we can avoid another human disorders. The consequences of stress. Now, what are the major consequences of stress? So stress is affecting four major pillars of our body. Four major pillars. One is it affects the human body, it affects the mind, it affects the behavior, and it affects the emotions. Now, in case of body, so you will feel a kind of fatigue, headache, taut muscles, skin irritations, frequent infections. So constrained breathing, you will have a problem in breathing. So all these kind of symptoms basically denote the stress, mind, the worry. It will affect your decision capability. You will not be able to take a decision. It will induce negativity in your mind, foggy thinking, hasty decision, impaired judgment. So all these are consequences of stress on the human mind. In behavior, substance abuse, you will feel loss of appetite, accident prone. Normally, when a person is in stress, so there are maximum chances for the accident. Restlessness, insomnia, in emotions, loss of confidence, you will feel less confident, apprehension, indifference, depression, irritability. So stress, if you do not manage stress at an early stage, it may take a severe form for depression, anxiety, and other human psychological disorder, like mood disorder, eating disorder, and personality disorders. So there are a huge list for these kind of disorder. So who are the victims of stress? You know, nowadays, everybody is suffering from one or another kind of stress. Students, businessman, employee, parent, politician, administration, all these persons are suffering from stress in one or in another. Students have a stress related to their career, related to their examination. Businessmen have a stress related to their profit. Employee have a stress related to the relation with the boss, the promotion. Parents have a stress related to their kids, related to their family, related to the career of their children. Politicians have different kind of stress. Administration have a different level and a different kind of stress. So ultimately, everybody is suffering from one or another kind of stress. Major causes of occupational stress. Now, you know, in the occupation for a salaried person, so stress is affecting, stress has different kind of consequences. Your role ambiguity may induce stress when you are not sure about your role. Rotating work shift may induce stress, role conflict, occupational demand, lack of participation in decision making when you are not involved in some kind of decision making. Obviously, you feel some kind of stress, work overload, work underload. So all these parameters, lack of group cohesiveness, organizational changes, lack of social support, career concern. So all these parameters are the major causes or the major stressor for the occupational, for the employees. So effect of stress on human body. So from this diagram that you are able to see on the screen, so almost every organ of the human body has been affected by this kind of human psychological disorder. So it affects the mouth disorders, decreased saliva flow, mouth ulcers, cardiac disorder, heart attack, stroke, problem due to high or low blood pressure, stomach, pancreas and intestine disorder are all related to the stress, muscle and joint disorder. You will be surprised to know that skin disorder, psoriasis is one of the kind of a skin disorder, is also associated with the stress. Lung disorder, asthma, lung cancer, cystic fibrosis, liver related problems, the reproductive disorders, irregular menstruations, fibroid, all these kind of human problems are related to stress. And obviously the psychological disorder, anxiety, depression, post-traumatic stress, hypertension, eating addiction, sleeping disorders, all these are related to stress in one or in another way. So from this diagram, it's very clear that stress is a very dangerous kind of human disease, and we need to give a very critical kind of attention for the diagnosis as well as the management of this human psychiatric disorder. So stress-based human disorder that we have discussed, psychological, neurological, and other human disorders. Schizophrenia, you know, a mental disorder which is normally related to a memory. This is also related to stress. Autism. So all these we have discussed that stress is stress may induce a severe form of stress may induce psychological, neurological, cardio and other kind of critical human disorders. Now, what is a stress diagnostic system? How we will measure stress? So several medical techniques, clinical tests, psychological evaluations, and other laboratory tests have been designed for the diagnosis of different human disorders. Moreover, several computational models have also been developed for early diagnosis of different human disorders. Like we have designed a disease diagnostic system for diabetes, for cancer, and for other human disorder. However, still more reformist and a united solution is needed that can offer a therapeutic opinion to individual patients. So we need to explore machine learning, soft computing, nature-inspired computing, IoT, and other emerging techniques that can be used for diagnosis of this kind of human psychological disorders. Machine learning. Now, let us first understand the machine learning. So machine learning is basically, it is a type of artificial intelligence that allow software application to become more accurate at predicting outcomes without being explicitly programmed to do so. So that is, it learns with data without being explicitly programmed. So it is a branch of artificial intelligence that concerned with design, development of algorithms that allow computer to evolve behavior based on the empirical data. So what is the specialty of the machine learning? It makes the system capable to automatically learn and improve from experience without being explicitly programmed. So ultimately, there are three types of machine learning technique basically. So what are these three types of machine learning techniques? So one is the supervised learning, we have unsupervised learning, and we have reinforcement learning. So what is the supervised learning? This is, in this type of machine learning, data scientists supply algorithms with labeled training data and define the variables they want the algorithm to assess for correlation. Because in this case, a labeled data has been given, that is why this is called supervised learning. Both the input and output of the algorithm is specified. So this is normally used for classification purpose. Now, what is unsupervised learning? This is normally related to clustering. So unsupervised learning means this type of machine learning involves algorithm that train on unlabeled data. The difference between supervised and unsupervised is, in case of supervised learning, the data is labeled, and in case of unsupervised learning, there is no labeling at all. Now, what is the reinforcement learning? It is typically used to teach a machine to complete a multi-step process for which there are clearly defined rules. So data scientist programs an algorithm to complete a task and give it positive or negative cues as a feedback as it work out how to complete a task. So, but for the most part, the algorithm designed on its own what steps to take along the way. So supervised learning, unsupervised learning, reinforcement learning, these kind of techniques have been used in wide sphere, have been used in wide varieties of areas. So like supervised learning can be used in classification and regression, image classification, customer retention, diagnostic, forecasting, predictions, process optimization, new insights. So these are some of the key areas for the supervised learning. For unsupervised learning, clustering and the dimension reduction, feature elicitations, structure discovery, meaningful compression, big data visualization, recommender system, targeted marketing and customer segmentation are some of the key areas that are normally used with unsupervised learning. And in reinforcement learning, we have real-time decisions, artificial intelligence games, robot navigations, skill acquisition, etc. So these are certain applications of machine learning. Now let us understand emerging nature-inspired computing techniques. There, nowadays, we have learned that nature provides a grand design. And nature is superb. Nature provides us different clues for optimization of different real life problems. So based upon the natural concepts, we have a wide categories of nature-inspired computing techniques. We have derived an algorithm based upon the collective behavior of ants. That is ant colony algorithm, ant colony optimization, firefly algorithm, cuckoo search, monkey algorithm, gray wolf optimizer, blue whale optimization, ant loin algorithm, crow search algorithm, emperor penguin algorithms. So a huge list, more than 150 algorithms have been designed and implemented to solve a wide variety of real life applications. So we have a very huge list, so it's not possible to cover the complete list of the nature-inspired computing techniques. So some of the important algorithms which are normally used are genetic algorithm. We have Firefly algorithm, was devised by Renshi Yang in 2007. Cuckoo algorithm, inspired by the obligate brute parasitism, and was designed in 2009. Monkey algorithm, inspired by climbing tree and the food foraging problem. Gray wolf optimizer was designed by Syed Mirzalali, inspired by the group hunting behavior. Ant colony optimization, again designed by Syed Mirzalali, inspired by the larva based hunt mechanism. So whale optimization, crow search optimization, inspired by the intelligent behavior and memory of the group. So laying chicken algorithm, butterfly optimization, emperor. This is one of the recent kind of nature-inspired and the swarm intelligent meta-heuristic technique, emperor penguin optimizer, has been recently launched in 2019. So genetic algorithm is one of the core soft computing technique. This is a bio-inspired computing technique, was proposed by Johan Bollett, borrow its essential feature from the human genetics. So genetic algorithms are the stochastic technique. So that provide a good solution in a minimal amount of time. So three important operators for GA are selection, crossover, and mutation. I'm not going into the details of these algorithms. So crossover operations, how the crossover operation is performed, mutation operation. So there are wide techniques or algorithms for selection, for crossover, for mutation. Gray wolf optimizer, so another meta heuristic technique. Hunting behavior is based on hunting behavior of the gray wolves. So you know it is a member of Kennedy family, so normally live in the group. So collective behavior is basically collective behavior of gray wolves inspired the author to design a gray wolf optimizer. So all of these nature-inspired computing techniques have been used to solve a wide variety of real-life applications. So these have been effectively used in disease diagnosis. So wide variety of human diseases have been effectively diagnosed with these kind of meta-heuristic techniques. So now Internet of Things. So you know it is defined as a network of physical objects like devices, vehicles, building, embedded items, software, sensors, network connectivity, etc. So ultimately, what is the Internet of Things? It is a combination of sensors, network, people, and things. So all these are combined to generate a new concept which is known as IoT. So a big year for IoT was 1999. The Internet of Things term is coined by Kevin Ashton. So So in 2005, ITU, from any time, any place, connectivity for anyone, for anything, a dynamic network of IoT. So IoT is basically, IoT has extended the concept of computer network or the internet, in which we were restricted to use the computing machines only. So rather than computing machines, in case of an IoT, we can connect different kind of physical object, like a washing machine, a vehicle, a building, any kind of other devices. So there are a lot of applications of IoT. So before understanding the applications of IoT, so let us understand how it works. So first of all, device connection is required. Then data sensing and collection process starts. Data transport and access services start. Then data analytics will be carried out. Data values defined by action, and finally human value app and experiences. Now, IoT growth. So what is IoT growth? So from this diagram, it is clear that the maximum growth of IoT devices is in healthcare and in manufacturing. Whereas this need to be the use of this technology, Internet of Things, need to be explored for real estate as well as agriculture. No doubt in agriculture, the researchers have already started the concept of smart farming and smart agriculture, but still it need to be explored in a deeper way as compared to the healthcare and the manufacturing section. So this is how IoT application will work. So IoT in smart farming, IoT is used in smart farming. It is also used in capturing store insight for timely engagement of the customers and the things. So it is used in smart city, wearable devices, as well as in the healthcare sector. Now with the help of IoT devices, we are able to monitor, we are able to remotely monitor the exact status of the patient. So this is very useful in healthcare sector. Now, we have discussed, till now we discussed stress as a kind of human psychological disorder that has a very critical kind of consequences and that need to be diagnosed. Then we stated that for the diagnosis of the stress, we need a very smart and an intelligent kind of system. For this, we need to hybrid a different kind of emerging technology, soft computing and machine learning and all these. Now, another important technology which is prevailing nowadays is called context-aware computing. Earlier, traditional computing, in case of traditional computing, what was done? Explicit input was given to the computer system, and explicit output was observed. Humans were in the loop. Context independent, act exactly the same. Each time you will get a similar kind of output for the similar kind of input. Means there was, nowadays the scenario has been changed. Now we have moved to context-aware computing. Now what is this context-aware computing? It is essentially a type of computer operation that anticipates cases of use, or in other words, work in customized way based on the context of the user activity. Now, based upon the requirement, like in case of your mobile, you know, when you move to the sunlight, the brightness will be automatically increased. When you come to a room in shadow, the brightness of your mobile smartphone is automatically decreased. How this is happening? This is context switching. This is context-aware computing. Your mobile is sensing the context. Mobile is sensing the brightness, the sunlight. And based upon this context, the brightness will be increased or decreased. So in case of context-aware system, what is the scenario? We have explicit input, we have explicit output, but based upon the context. Context means the state of the user, the state of the physical environment, the state of the computing system. So these kind of system are able to adapt their operations to the current context without explicit user involvement. So emphasis is on improving usability and effectiveness by taking environmental context into account. Context, it can be a computing context, connectivity, communication, user context, it can be user profile, it can be location, it can be nearby people, physical context, temperature, lighting, noise, traffic. It can be time context, maybe the time of the day, maybe morning, afternoon, maybe evening. So that can be a context. So context aware computing means sensing, thinking, and acting. So sense its environment to characterize the context, collect information to use it intelligently, and adapt to changing situation. So software that examine and react to an individual changing context to deliver right service at right moment. So context-aware computing, so this is how context-aware computing is helpful in healthcare system. So this is GPS, thinking, acting. So data will be collected based upon the position of, based upon the health condition of the person, the system will be automatically send a message to the healthcare professional to see the patient. So this is how the context-aware computing is useful in healthcare system. Now this is the general automated disease diagnostic healthcare framework. What we are doing for the disease diagnosis, we need a data set that can be taken from hospitals, psychiatric clinic, research center, online repositories, or by interacting with the patients. Then data need to be pre-processed. We need to select the optimal features. The data need to be used for training and testing, and we need to design a system. And then the system needs to be validated. So ultimately, this is the traditional approach for the diagnostic healthcare framework. So what is required nowadays, this kind of system is required nowadays. We need a design of smart and intelligent healthcare diagnostic system for psychological disorder patients. So how this can be implemented? So we will implant a biosensor for collecting the patient's data. Internet of Things need to be associated. Energy optimized devices need to be used. In case of IoT, when we use these devices, the major concern is their battery life. So we need to use energy optimized devices so that it can operate for a long time. The patient data will be collected manually and using IoT through sensor and the wearable devices. The data need to be secure in healthcare sector. So the prime concern is to make your data secure. So for this kind of security, so we can employ different kind of data security mechanism, endpoint validation, PAM, masking, granular access control, two-factor authentication, all these can be used as data security techniques. The data need to be processed. The granular computing, ontology, chatbot, fuzzy logic, and the machine learning along with the soft computing techniques need to be used to mine data so that we can have an optimal result. So why we are using fuzzy logic? Because in case of healthcare, we may have uncertain data. So to deal with uncertainty, we need to employ a kind of fuzzy logic. Chatbot will be beneficial. So some of the queries of the patients can be handled directly by the chatbot. So granular computing will help us to focus on particular specific aspect. So all these things need to be hybrid. All these things need to be converge on a single platform. So we need to combine biosensor, IoT, machine learning, soft computing, sentiment analysis. Why sentiment analysis need to be used for the psychological disorder patient? We can mine their data that they have posted on the social media or through say your WhatsApp or other kind of media. So that their actual mental state can be examined. So along with context aware computing, so ultimately, so what is required? We need to hybrid different platforms. Challenges. Real time and unbiased data is one of the major challenges. The selection of the best meta heuristic and the machine learning technique is again a problem, because there are wide varieties of machine learning and soft computing techniques. So we need to find out the best fit. IoT, we need to focus on energy consumption. We need to focus on throughput, reliability, authentication, along with the integrity. Challenge in context-aware computing. That is context representation. The frequency of context updation. How many times the context will be updated? How the context will be updated? Necessary sensors and their infrastructure. IoT security. The security issues, when we try to embed IoT, you know, HP revealed that 70% of most commonly used IoT devices contain vulnerability, including password security, encryption, and general lack of granular user access permissions. So design of ontology for the healthcare is again a problem. Sufficient resources, feature selection. Hybridization of emerging technique is required. The last and not least, collaboration of researchers. So for this kind of a system, the collaboration of the researchers from the different domains, from the healthcare professionals, computer scientists, data scientists, mathematicians, statisticians, all the collaboration is required. Funding, which is again a problem for this kind of system. So all these are the challenges that we need to take care of. So conclusions, ultimately lifestyle is one of the major reasons for the critical health-related disorders. So a lot of work has been done for the early diagnosis of several critical disorders. However, very little attention has been paid to design automated healthcare system for psychological disorder patient as compared to other human disorders like diabetes, cancer, cardiac. So therefore, there is need to design a smart and intelligent healthcare system for the different psychological disorders, particularly the stress. So we need interdisciplinary research collaboration. So thank you very much for your patience. So all the best for your future endeavors. Thank you very much.
Very warm welcome to everyone. My name is Ansh Pujara. The topic for my presentation is food demand forecast for online food delivery services using CatBoost model. Demand forecast is a very important factor for any online business that has to deal with supply chain and management. Most of such business that deals with supply chain and management, for example food delivery businesses, if we talk about, face difficulties like perishable raw materials, which makes it perhaps more essential to forecast daily or weekly demands more accurately. Prediction of such type of raw materials depends upon numerous factors, like what type of food is ordered or are the raw materials easily accessible in the vicinity. Online food ordering is a way of ordering food online through a website or a mobile application that is handled either by a mediator services like Uber Eats, Zomato or Swiggy in India, or the restaurant or food vendor itself. Ordering food for delivery usually includes contacting the restaurant services or the vendors directly by phone or telephone, and they will deliver the food to your doorstep in a few minutes, less than 30 minutes actually. Since the rise of the online food delivery services that happened in 1994, the online food delivery market has risen up to billions of dollars, shown by certain market studies that in 2019 it was worth of $9 billion. It started in early 1990s when famous pizza delivery chain Pizza Hut started accepting orders through online mode. Since then, certain mediator services like Uber Eats, Zomato, Swiggy have risen in the market and have served as an easy way to access each and every restaurant in your nearest neighborhood or maybe far from your home to get the food to your door. The problem we are focusing here is about forecasting the demand accurately for any online delivery service or restaurant services. It will help them prevent the replenishment of raw materials in the future. For any online food delivery services, demand forecast depends upon certain factors like what type of food is ordered from which restaurant or which service center from where they deliver the food. Our main task is to predict the number of orders that they will be facing in the upcoming 3 months using the historical data of past 3 years we have collected through online mode. But after predicting the number of orders for next 3 months, it will help them predict the amount of raw materials they will be requiring to meet those orders without any fail, and it will help them rise their business more. In the past, there have been several models proposed specifically for demand forecasting in departments such as cold chain logistics and supply chain management. Models like Holtwinter's ARIMA model, gray forecasting, they are all based on time series, and certain variations in these models like exponential smoothing with the trends are very important factors for the forecast. The system proposed of CAT Boost makes use of gradient boosting algorithm for predicting the target variables. CAT Boost offers unique ways of dealing with categorical features, unlike other gradient boosting algorithms, which uses one-hot encoding of features. CAT Boost utilizes a more efficient procedure that reduces overfitting, and it also allows to utilize the entire dataset for preparation and training the model. It uses oblivious trees as base predictors, where for each and every splitting, the same criteria is used over a whole level of tree point. Initially, CAT Boost generates some random independent permutations of the dataset. Later, apart from the first one, the other permutations will be used for evaluation of the splits, and the first permutation that we discarded for the evaluation will be used for choosing the leaf values of the trees obtained. In order to prevent prediction shift, CAT Boost makes use of permutations that are equal or equivalent. The dataset used in this research study contains data about the type of orders and the number of orders from a restaurant and its different franchisees from different cities. The time frame of the data is 3 years, that is, the historical data collected is of 3 years. It contains several categorical features which have a direct impact on the target variable, that is the number of orders. Certain variables like type of food order or the name or type of the center from which the food is delivered, they have a very direct impact on the target variable. The target variable here is number of orders that we're going to predict, which is a numerical variable. The algorithm of CAT Boost is as follows. Initially, one categorical feature is chosen from the dataset. Next, a row from the training dataset is chosen randomly, and a random level of this categorical feature chosen is exchanged with a number. The number that is chosen is based on the estimated output variable. Then a splitting function is used to construct two different sets of training data, one which will have all greater target variables, and the other one will have all the smaller target variables. This carries on for the complete training data set and until all the categorical feature values or feature combinations are exchanged with a number. As a result, each and every categorical feature values is assigned a numerical feature. To convert the categorical features into numerical features, CatBoost follows the following procedures. First, it starts with permutating the set of input objects into a random order. Then it converts the label value from a floating point to an integer. Then it follows two different methods for regression and classification. For regression, quantization is performed on the label values. A bucket of integers ranging from 0 to k, where k depends upon the categorical feature and its label values. All the values located inside that bucket of integers are assigned to a label value. And like this it performs say the same procedure for all the categorical variables, and at last each and every label level of the categorical feature are replaced with a numeric feature. It can be observed that CatBoost has shown some improved result with respect to some very popular dataset that has categorical features in it. For example, adult dataset Amazon and Epsilon dataset, it has shown some very state-of-the-art results with an improvement from LightGVM and XGBoost, some very popular machine learning libraries that uses gradient boosting algorithm to deal with categorical features as well as numeric features. The implementation was carried out in Python 3 using the CatBoost library by Yandex. The model built here was a regression model implemented using CatBoost regressor provided in the CatBoost library itself. CatBoost provides a way of hyperparameter tuning using grid search, where it builds a model for every combination of hyperparameters. It can be observed that the three of the main hyperparameters, the learning rate, depth of the tree, and L2 regularization value, are finalized as 0.02, 8, and 10 respectively, which provides us an RMSE value of 0.44. After implementing the model, it can be observed that CatBoost has shown some improvement in the valuation metric, that is the root mean squared error values and root mean squared logarithmic error values, as compared to the LightGVM and XGBoost models. As it can be seen here, the root mean square error value for LightGVM is 0.583, for XGBoost 0.813, and for CatBoost it shows the least error, that is 0.446. Same as the root mean squared logarithmic error value for LightGVM is 0.218, for XGBoost 0.146, and for CatBoost it is 0.0887, which is a very good improvement as compared to other algorithms. The fit of the model can be observed from the given graph, as we can see the predicted values in the orange and the true values in the blue almost coincide each other. This shows that the accuracy of CatBoost is very high. It also provides a way to compare the feature importance by giving an importance score to each of the feature, which shows the relative importance of each and every variable on the prediction. From the research, we can conclude that CatBoost provides an improved performance as compared to other gradient boosting techniques. And also, it can be seen that when it comes to demand forecast, historical data plays a major role to predict the future values. Also, demand forecasting plays an essential role in the growth of any business. It by helping to determine the quantities that should be purchased, produced, and shipped. The following is the list of research papers and studies that were referred during this research. Thank you.
Good morning to one and all. I am Uma Maheshwari, research scholar of CSE department, NET. My guide is Dr. C. Mala, professor of CSE department. Co-guide is Dr. A. Santana Vijayan, assistant professor of CSE department. I am going to present my research paper, A Novel Coherent Architecture for Traffic Signal Management in Internet. Overview of this presentation is introduction, literature survey, proposed CATSME and its ontology, simulation and results discussion, conclusion and then references. Introduction, Internet of Things. IoT is the network of physical objects embedded with electronics, software, sensors and network connectivity. IoT enables these objects to collect and exchange data. It associates smart elements together by using network connectivity to send and receive data. Internet of Vehicles. IoV is evolving from VANET to achieve vision of smartphone to smart car. It is an indispensable platform with information interaction among vehicles, human and infrastructure. It has advanced features and enables modern vehicles to ensure driver safety. Advantages of Internet of Vehicles. IoV provides safe driving, convenient service, traffic guidance system, safe navigation, intelligent vehicle control, crash prevention, electronic toll collection, and traffic flow monitoring. Intelligent transportation system is an emerging transportation system comprised of an advanced information and internet for users, roads and vehicles. It's an integrated application of advanced technologies, computers, communication and sensing devices are here used. This ITS is used to improve the efficiency and safety. It absorbs information from the environment, other vehicles and from the driver. Vehicle reduction and surveillance technologies are an integral part of ITS. Literature survey. Pamba Sathukan et al. Proposed an Internet of Things based intelligent traffic congestion control system. This paper dynamically sets the signal operation time based on measured values of traffic congestion density. Nafer Fatmes et al. Presented vehicle identification method by using RFID and GSM compatible with IEEE 802.15.4 for 2.4 GHz. This paper giving a full computation of highway checking with a distant observing station by utilizing both systems. Paulosis et al. Discussed various scenarios for improving this control by installing RFID readers and tags on road infrastructure and on vehicles, respectively or vice versa. This work allowing authorized vehicles only by verifying the vehicle's information. And so the controlling is possible to access zones with restrictions by using RFID. The above existing works discusses the traffic signal management using Internet of Vehicles. It is seen that the existing work does not have the ability to overcome the lost information during the failure of communication in IoV. Challenges. There is no consistency in the availability of information such as traffic vehicle speed or density or volume headway, etc. Due to that, there is low propagation delay or high network utility. Due to dynamic network, communication failure occurs frequently. Existing work divides in exploring the concept of mutually benefit of multiple traffic information acquisition sensors. Proposed architecture. Proposed a pilot novel architecture known as coherent architecture for traffic signal management in Internet of Vehicles called CATSME. This for common set availability of information such as traffic vehicle speed, density or volume headway, etc. during low propagation delay or high network utility. In this work, alternate source enables in CATSME is to improve the quality and precision of applications that entirely depend on wireless communication of Internet of Vehicles that are prone to attacks and the failure of information communication. this work uses RFID as backup of information to manage the traffic efficiently by improving and ensuring information availability. Proposed CASME is the proposed architecture called the coherent architecture for traffic signal management in Internet of Vehicles. In this architecture, the traffic information are acquired from RFID through roadside unit and also from onboard unit. These traffic information are processed in the control center. Here various input resources has to be interfaced by using DataX. After processing, information is sent to the traffic management applications for monitoring and controlling purpose. Radio frequency identification model. In this model, three sections of RFID systems. One is RFID model, second one is information transmission model, third one is information handling model. In RFID model, a vehicle electronic tag and reader writer are data is stored in the RFID tag electronically. This data is retrieved by the reader using electromagnetic waves. Tags can store only a few kilobytes of data. The operation of RFID reader is similar to barcode scanning method, which uses UPC called the Universal Product Codes. In the information transmission model, coaxial cable and router are available for transmission purpose. In the information preparing part is the control center, which processes the data and sends the information to the traffic signal. Advantages of RFID. It does not require line of sight. Reader can read more than 40 tags at a time. RFID has the ability to read, write and update the data present in it. Control center and the DataX2 model. Here, control center acquires the information from infrastructure and also from vehicles. Process centrally the information and monitoring all the activities of the infrastructure by transmitting safety and enforcement related alerts. DataX2 interface is a standard interface to exchange data across different entities of transport system level for road segments. It allows the exchange of traffic information across multiple sources integrated with the operator. This interface allows establishing a stable environment for system specification using widely used unified markup language. Traffic signal management model is a real-time application to manage traffic effectively. This model switches over traffic between various directions across road segments. Traffic signal phase cycles are timers used for traffic signal management. Here, fixed period of time leading to increase the waiting time of vehicles. Due to different traffic density, the phase cycle time needs to be changed automatically to minimize the congestion. Traffic information obtained from OBU and the RFID to calculate green phase cycle for various road segments and communicates through a network to exchange information. Ontology for proposed CASME. The ontology for CASME enables to understand the details of the data, representations, relationships, roles, and responsibilities of the entities. Here applications are represented as application ID 1, application ID 2, and so on up to application ID N. Here it requires traffic information for different segments of roads for its operability. The segments of the road are represented as segment ID 1, segment ID 2, and so on up to segment ID S. The traffic information such as volume, density, and speed is obtained from two sources as per proposed CASME, that is OBU from small vehicles and also the DataX for same traffic information is from RFID tags. Here DataX is the interface. Actually, it gets the information from OBU and also from RFID tags. But it gives the output in the same format for compatible purpose. Algorithm for estimating green phase time for traffic signal management. In the first step, the duration required to transfer or clear out vehicles in signal is dt is equal to L1 plus s dot v. Here, where dt is the duration of time required to transfer or clear out vehicles through signal. L1 is the startup last time. S is the saturation headway second. In the second step, one of the road segment in the traffic signal is given default green phase, which can be changed manually. In the third step, the vehicle density are categorized into low, medium, high, and very high density, and calculate their corresponding headway. The maximum density using CASME is identified, and the time dt is calculated. In the fourth step, calculate the difference or variation in dt, and the previous green phase time also calculated. In the fifth step, calculate the current green phase time using the sum of variation in step 4 and the previous green phase time. In the sixth step, the green phase time is always maintained within a predefined minimum and maximum time limit. In the seventh step, the green phase time for all the roads of the traffic signal are calculated in the descending order of traffic vehicle density using step 1 to 6 obtained from CASME. Traffic density simulation using SIM. The performance of the proposed CASME for traffic signal management is analyzed using the simulated values of traffic information. The traffic density for traffic signal management from Internet of Vehicles and also from RFID obtained from Unique ID by using SIM. Here, figure shows the screenshot of simulation in SIM. Simulation of traffic density. Few observation of simulation of traffic density that are anonymously used for the Internet of Vehicles and RFID. Here, x-axis shows the observation, whereas the y-axis shows the number of vehicles per kilometer. This figure shows the simulated values of the traffic density. Simulation of loss of traffic information. Simulated values for the loss of information from Internet of Vehicles of onboard unit are simulated for several observations. Figures 5 is the simulated values for loss of traffic information. Here also x-axis is the observation and y-axis is the availability of information. Here actually there is only two levels, either is available or not. Available is shown in terms of one, the same binary bits. Non-availability is shown by 0. So here 0 and 1 are represented to give the loss of information. Loss of information is nothing but 0. Available information is indicated by 1. Performance analysis of CASME. Green phase for traffic signal using CASME. Figure shows the traffic information with the loss of information, that is with CASME and without CASME. The result of the green phase cycle for low and high traffic density is shown. A green phase time required to clear the vehicle is dt. Green band phase cycle becomes the default minimum value irrespective of the traffic density. In this figure, precision of traffic signal green phase time without CASME is 79.2%, whereas precision of traffic signal green phase time with CASME is 91.3%. Figure shows the green phase for traffic signal using CASME. Advantages of proposed work. Here, green band phase compensates the loss data. Traffic density pattern varied based on the result, and also transit of vehicle speed may be improved during peak hours. This work ensures vehicle density information with improved accuracy and consistency. The time for green phase of signal of each phase cycle is maintained consistent and updated based on the traffic density of the road segment. Green band phase cycle time for traffic signal management shows improved values with 91.3% of accuracy. Conclusion in this work proposed a pilot novel coherent architecture for traffic signal management using Internet of Vehicle to improve the precision and the quality of traffic signal management. Here, CASME uses RFID to compensate the loss of information from internet of vehicle based wireless communication. This work, the simulated values of traffic density information from onboard unit and also from RFID for traffic signal management. Traffic signal management using the proposed CASNI shows improved and decreased values with 91.3% accuracy. The references, in this references for this work, the following papers are referred to show. Thank you.
This presentation is regarding improved rider optimization algorithms based on link aware fault detection methodology, that is IROA, LAFT kinds of scheme based methodology. These kinds of methodologies mainly for managed kinds of components, that is mobile ad hoc network based type of securing network methodology. So these are the authors who have worked towards processing on these kinds of methods. So the securing main abstract in terms of analyzing these kinds of components, see, in a dynamic network like MAN, that is these kinds of mobile ad hoc network kinds of components is considered as a crucial as well as a demanding task for accessing and analyzing of these kinds of methods. So with the help of these kinds of securing communications in a dynamic networks like these kinds of MANET operations, it will be much more easier and accessible in provoking all those kinds of methods. So here, sir, there will be a possibility of different kinds of faulty links that will be that will stop the processing, stop the networking flow of communications. So these need to be detected for attaining a better performance in terms of reliability and availability of these kinds of mobile nodes in the network. So we have to make sure that these kinds of reliable, available type of mobile nodes in the network type of components should be recovered or should be accessed or provoked using these kinds of methodology. So we should be clear, or we should be able to process or analyze these efficient methods, these efficient type components in analyzing or accessing of these kinds of modularity. So one of the main thing we need to consider in provoking these kinds of components, how far we are able to analyze or access these kinds of components, these kinds of methodology. So the attackers that need to be detected through a single stage attack detection kinds of process, it will be in a proactive way. So it will guarantee that the quality of service in the networks will not be compromised. So we should make sure, or we should think about the quality of service in the network that has been presented or accessed here. So in this paper, they are proposing an improved type of rider optimization algorithms. It will be based on link aware fault detection kinds of methodology. It will be proposed for facilitating several kinds of securities by mitigating gray hole or black hole kinds of attacks with enhanced link kinds of stability. See, these are the different kinds of possible methodology. So the IROA LAFT scheme targets on mutating the packets. It will be dropping by in a potential manner type of components will be based on the steps that will include the discovery of these kinds of neighbor nodes, detection of attacks, analysis of links, transmissions of secure packets, link fault detection using IROA type of algorithms. So these are the different kinds of schemes that will be analyzed. These are different types of components that we can invoke or access using these kinds of methodology. So in particular, this IROA is used for exploring the link paths that will be established in these kinds of networks. It will create a term called trust node type of components. So through these kinds of trust nodes, we are able to process or replicate or analyze on these kinds of methodology. So here we are going to see about rider optimization algorithm, that is ROA type of algorithm. So here, in terms of these kinds of improvised rider optimization algorithm based link factor or our fault detection methodology, that is IROA LAFT scheme, is proposed for facilitating the security in the ad hoc kinds of network. So it's mitigating some of gray hole or black hole attacks with any enhanced link stability kinds of components. This IROA LAFT scheme targets on mitigating the packet dropping by in a potential manner. So the steps of these kind of proposed type of methodology will be much more helpful, including on those kinds of methodology. So the discovery of neighbor, route, or detection of attack. So there are several kinds of techniques that will be included in processing of these kinds of methods. First and foremost will be discovery of neighbor and route based methodology, detection of attack, analysis of link, transmission of secure packets, and link fault detection using IROA type of algorithm methodology. So the various kinds of method, various kinds of components will be there. So we have to find it, or we have to discover the neighbors and the route for analyzing those kinds of neighbor nodes. Then detection of attacks, what will be those kinds of attacks we need to establish our techniques in order to avoid those kinds of attacks. Analysis of link based factor, so how these kinds of link based factors will be enabled. Then transmissions of secure packets and the link fault detection using these IROA algorithms. These are different kinds of methodology or component related features. In terms of discovery of neighbor and route, in this phase, the construction of these kinds of methodology will be initiated, and the neighbors are discovered by broadcasting several hello packets. So these are some of the acknowledgement packets and initialization of the communications. So once a communication has been initialized, means then we can start the processing methodology. So the hello packets are mainly broadcast mainly for minimizing network traffic and overhead type of components. So in this phase, the utility of each kind of mobile node is taken into account for the neighbor and route discovery kinds of methodology. So it will be mainly for accounting of your neighbors as well as route discovery, so that the path via transmission will be much more smoother and much more easier in provoking. This discovery of the route and neighbor is attained based on the network topology and configurations that exist in the proximity within these kinds of source node that initiated the communication based methodology. So for the discovering of these kinds of route and neighbor is attained based on these kinds of network topology and configurations that will be exhibit in these kinds of proximity kinds of source methods. Then RREQ kinds of packets are forwarded by these kinds of source nodes to the mobile nodes that will be around a transmission range of 200 meters. So the transmission range is a short type of range kinds of components minimized type of methodology. The next and foremost will be the detection of attack. In this step, the attacker nodes are identified. Of the node, route is established among those kinds of mobile nodes and are stored into the set of suspect kinds of components. The gray hole and back hole attackers are identified during these kinds of process of data disintegration. So the two kinds of attackers will be easily identified and accessed. IROA LAFT kinds of our improvised or proposed scheme will focus on detecting these kinds of forward mentioned kinds of attacks before these kinds of commencement of data transmissions. So in case of any attacks has been determined, means then the mobile nodes that are compromised through these kinds of attacks are appended to the list of these suspects. So the route exists between these kinds of trustworthy components as well as attacker nodes are blocked and the communications will be disabled, so that the attackers will be identified, then will not be provoke any kinds of data. Once we detect those kinds of attackers, means the communications will be altered so that we cannot process on those kinds of method. So we can easily provoke a secure or the stability or the exposure of the data will not be compromised. So analyze, next and foremost will be the analysis of the link. So on the link, on the attackers are detected the path between the genuine nodes are established using these kinds of IROA algorithms. So with the help of an objective of verifying these kinds of link stability during these kinds of data disintegrations. So it is used for choosing the optimal path based on exploration of stability and optimizations. So in terms of stability optimization, we need to choose these kinds of optimal path accessibility. The complete process of link stability and analysis achieved by following steps. Step one, initialize the nodes in the network. So we have to initialize the nodes that has been present in the network. Second, calculate the relative velocity. So we have to calculate the relative velocity in the system, and the nearest neighbor mobile nodes will be based on our SSI estimation. So what will be our SSI estimation means received signal strength indicator. So this is the indicator through which we can easily acquire, analyze, access the neighbor nodes. Then estimate the data bandwidth. So you have to estimate the data bandwidth, response time, and queue length associated with each node. So these are three kinds of methods: the bandwidth, response time, queue length associated with each kind of node-based methodology. Then step four will determine about the factor of link quality, FLQ, using these kinds of data bandwidth, response time, and queue length. These are the this is a formula mainly to find FLQ, that is factor of link quality. Then the step five will sort the mobile nodes in the list based on the identify RSSI neighbor as well as FLQ parameters. So here we are ignoring two kinds of components: RSSI neighbor, FLQ parameters. So with the help of these two kinds of components, you can easily sort down the mobile nodes. Initiate the process of link construction based on information present in the list. So we have to find the process of link construction based on these kinds of information. Compute the global value related to identify RSSI neighbor FLQ parameters for employing these heuristic based fitness search based methodology. So with the help of these kinds of heuristic kinds of based methodology, we have initiated the global value kinds of components. Then update the list each time by extracting the measures of these kinds of link quality. So if you have started doing it, you have to repeat the step six from step six. So step six, step seven, step eight, that is, you have to again repeat the initialization process of these kinds of process link communications, then compute the global value related to these kinds of identify RSSI neighbor and FLQ parameters for employing these kinds of heuristic based fitness search. Then update the search each time by extracting the measures of link quality. Then we have to see about the transmissions of secure packets link fault detection using this IROA algorithm. So this bypass radar has a capability of reaching these kinds of target based on the path of these kinds of lead, and the group radar is initiated based on the equations. So this is the equations where NR and DRP refers to the number of riders and dimensions that is used in the problem for optimization at a time instant, that is T. In every time instant, it is referred that bypass riders are always in the leading position that can be calculated. So that is the formula. Here we are given the formula to infer that bypass riders that has been initiating are accessing here. Here alpha and beta refers to the random numbers that lies in the range 0, 1 and 0, r respectively. The following riders always arrives at the destination by following the bypass rider. So with the help of bypass rider, we can easily find the destination. So in terms of analyzing these kind of destinations, we can easily use these kind of bypass rider. The path transferred by the following rider completely depends upon the bypass rider. So in this context, the position of the follower is updated. So here the formula will enhance the updated version. So the position of the outtaker search agent is updated as well as initiated methodology. So whereas the PIR DWI kinds of components will be initiated or analyzed or accessed or invoked using these kinds of methods, these kinds of model applications, the value of these kinds of directions, value of these kinds of methodology will be initiated. The value of these kinds of direction indicator is computer is analyzed or accessed here. So with the help of these kinds of analyzed or accessed, we are supposed to invoke, we are supposed to process the value type kinds of constraints, type kinds of modularity. So the value of these kinds of direction integrator is computed as well as initiated. The position of the attackers are updated or analyzed. So once and foremost, with the help of these kinds of methods, these kinds of modularity, the value of the direction is computed or accessed or processed. So the position of the attackers are updated using these kinds of formulas. So the rider as well as direction indicator, the value of those kinds of methods or those kinds of components, the value of the direction indicators is computed. So the position of the attackers are updated or invoked using this kind of formula. To represent the role of gravitational search in ROA, the rider position is given by these kinds of formula. So how far we are initiating these kinds of method, these kinds of components. So in these situations, acting force has been initialized. So the formula of these kinds of acting force is been given here. Based on these kinds of report mentioned equation, the position associated with the bypass rider following the overtaker and attacker are updated here using these sets of formulas. So follower, angle, overtaker and attacker, all these kinds of methods will initiate this kind of methodology. So BYI, follower, overtaker, attacker are the accelerator introduced in the process of improved rider optimization kind of algorithms. So now we'll see about the simulation results and discussion. So when comparing with other, that is EMP, SO, M-Line, kinds of Whale, F3DM methodology, our improvised version has better service of kinds. So number of mobile nodes, we are considering two kinds of possibility, number of mobile nodes, with related to the rate of packet losses. So when you see the rate of packet loss in our proposed systems has been dropped to a large margin, so this is the ideology, whereas here the rate of link failure detections in our proposed systems has been varied. So the failure detection has been identified to its maximum level when comparing with other methodologies. So previously we have the lowest rate in terms of data loss. So if the lowest rate means we have more failure detection methodology, so we are improvising the systems. So end-to-end delay in our proposed systems, so how far we are methoding, so end-to-end delay has been much reduced and it was much smaller when comparing with other type of methodology. So because of these methods, we can easily provoke our neighboring communications. Even the latency of the proposed systems, we can see how latency drop was there in our proposed systems. So these are several kinds of factors. So latency has been dropping here. So another thing, in terms of packet delivery, we are reaching a maximum kinds of percentage. Its ratio was much higher in packet delivery ratio. So when comparing or we are analyzing with other type of node-based methodology, we have a high accuracy rate, high rate in terms of packet delivery kind of methodology. And in terms of throughput kinds of methods, we have the highest throughput ratio, yes, throughput value in comparing with other type of model applications. So the concluded kinds of method, in our conclusions, the proposed improved rider optimization algorithm based link aware fault detection scheme calculates the relative velocity and nearest neighbor mobile nodes based on RSSI estimations. In addition to these kinds of data, bandwidth, response time and queue length association with each node with an objective of estimating the factor of link quality, that is FLQ kinds of methodology. FLQ aids in better exploration of links in order to identify whether they are being influenced by the gray hole or black hole attacks during these kinds of data disintegration kinds of components or process. In terms of data dissemination process methodology, we need to identify gray hole and black hole attackers. So in our proposed system, that is IRYA-LAFT scheme, which includes the gravitational search RYA algorithms for exploring the link path that has been established between the trust nodes of these kinds of networks. So in our proposed system scheme is identified to minimize the packet loss by 40.28% end-to-end delay by 12.94% and latency by 13.96% when compared to the benchmark schemes considered by investigation. So with the help of these kind of investigation methodology, our systems has been improvised or analyzed with several kinds of methods. These are the several reference papers we have considered in provoking or analyzing of these methods or these kinds of components. So our improvised or proposed type of method was much improved, much secured in identifying the neighbor package, neighbor accessibility, as well as it will be much more helpful in provoking different type of packet matching, packet analyzing. So with our improved type of proposed systems, we can easily access, we can easily connect with the neighboring packets, neighboring nodes in a minimal type of components. So we have an improved type of method, improved type of components in analyzing of these kinds of methodology. So with this, I will just wind up our presentation regarding our proposed systems. Thank you.
Respected learners, researchers, and juries of 3rd EAA International Conference on Big Data Innovation for Sustainable Cognitive Computing. I am Dr. L. Jubair Ahmed, Associate Professor of Department of ECE from Sri Ishwar College of Engineering, presenting a title on Fog-Assisted Real-Time Coronary Heart Disease Risk Reduction in IoT-Based Healthcare System. Coming to the outline of my presentation, introduction, review of literature, abstract, system architecture models, followed by results and discussion, conclusion, as well as references. Introduction, over the past few years in healthcare technologies, biomedical equipment leads a very rapid advancement in semiconductor industry. Mobile healthcare monitoring systems are popular in recent times based on size capability in real-time monitoring. Mobile-based monitoring encounters major challenges in low complexity as well as power-efficient systems. Combination of cloud and fog computing can be reformed as computing paradigms in the era of Internet of Things. Mobile cloud computing techniques finds application in computation intensive in EEG as well as ECG telemonitoring systems. Some of the issues faced in cloud computing is minimum local processing of signals as well as the quality of the services during real-time monitoring. While compared to this, fog computing provides energy efficiency in sensor nodes and enables distributed data storage as well as data compression. Coming to the problem, coronary heart disease, CHD, which occurs in the blood supply reduction due to the heart muscles. The blood supply reduction is due to cholesterol deposits in the blood vessels. So this CHD risk detection is highly essential for acute stroke prediction.
Now coming to the review of literature, these are the various surveys that is done for our work. Let us see in detail. In first approach, a smart personalized healthcare monitoring system is being developed for ECG signal monitoring, which is mainly used for storing the medical data storage and analysis. Author also suggested that coronary heart disease causes most of the heart related problems and which leads to very serious heart diseases. The next paper, where the author suggests a very few medical indicators are being used for this CHD risk assessments, are age, smoking habits and medical history. He also suggests that early identification of cardiovascular diseases is very essential for a very proper treatment. Based on this, the real-time monitoring system has been approached, where the ECG signal is being taken and the prediction of CHD is done based on two parameters, that is blood pressure as well as heart rate variability, that is HRV. And in the next approaches, where the CHD is detected based on irregular heart rate, which is mainly analyzed with the help of wavelets or wavelet transforms using FFT, that is fast Fourier transform as well as short time Fourier transforms, where the author also suggests that the analysis is done based on ECG wave pattern. In the ECG wave pattern, where the interval RR is being measured specifically in order to calculate the heartbeat in the range of milliseconds. The next review comes based on artificial intelligent approaches, where the first author suggests based on machine learning classifiers. So here the author also uses DWT, that is discrete wavelet transforms, based on time domain as well as frequency domain, where the classifiers are classified based on this DWT approach. And the author also says that in the HRV futures are extracted both in time and frequency domain based on three different frequency regions, say as very low frequency as well as low frequency and high frequencies. Since this particular approach is used extensively in various applications, then various approaches like artificial neural network, support vector machines, fuzzy logic and genetic algorithms have been used for the same CHT analysis. So in all the analysis, wavelets have been largely deployed for extracting the information from a biomedical signals. And due to the extensive use of this AI approaches, which leads to an advancement of ECG on chip, where the ECG wave pattern, that is QRS wave, can be detected and it can also be saved with lossless compression for wireless sensors. And finally, the author, the last author suggests that the ECG mixed signal SOCs can be used for arrhythmia monitoring, where the same ECG wave pattern, that is say as QT interval, can be used for predicting the stroke outcome. And the author also says that this ECG wave pattern has QRS complex, RR interval, P wave and QT interval will help to predict the abnormalities in CHT, in finding the CHT values.
Now coming to the abstract of my work is to propose and develop a system for coronary heart disease risk assessment using fog computed assisted IoT framework for telemedicine application, where CHT risk assessment is performed based on HRV future extracted from ECG signal. And in our paper, we had used various machine learning algorithms as decision tree classifiers, SVM, ANFIS, and KNN, etc. Coming to the system architecture model, the proposed work comprises of fog computing model, HRV future extraction, CHT risk assessments. This is our proposed fog computing model, where we collected the ECG data from MIT BIH database. And the hardware used in our proposed work is NIDAC and wearable device. Pre-processing and future extraction plays a major role in ECG signal analysis. The data analysis is done in both the statistical and frequency domain with the help of wavelets. In our work, we used COIF wavelet for better HRV feature extractions. CHT risk assessment is done with the help of machine learning based classifiers as shown in the figure. The prototype can be developed with a combination of wearable device and fog computing assisted frameworks. Coming to the results and discussions, these are the various outputs obtained for HRV extraction using bioorthogonal wavelet and COIF wavelets. Here you can see the various parameters obtained statistically for ECG data. We have also compared the results with various classifiers, namely decision tree classifier and SVM, KNN, as well as ANFIS. The performance matrix is calculated based on total classification accuracy. From the results, it is very clearly shown ANFIS classifier produces a maximum classification accuracy. Coming to the conclusion, a fog computing assisted IoT framework for telemedicine application has been proposed with machine learning based system for CHT risk detection using extracted HRV futures. The biomedical data we used in our work is ECG, blood volume, pulse, skin temperature, and the HRV parameters were obtained. And from the results and discussion, it is observed that the maximum classification accuracy is obtained as 96.88, and ANFIS classifier yields the maximum accuracy, that is say around 99.38% on classifying into normal as well as CHT risky. These are the various literatures which supported for my proposed work. Thank you. I thank the organizers and juries of EAI International Conference for this wonderful opportunity. Thank you for the patient listening.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Shyamala Devi, So I am going to present my paper in this BDCC conference. My paper title is A Hybrid Algorithm for Document Clustering Using Optimized Kernel Matrix and Unsupervised Constraints. So in this way, I have organized my presentation. Abstract. So this particular paper is all about document clustering. Document clustering plays a major role in data mining. That will be a helpful one in order to group our data, and that leads to retrieval process very easier. We have traditional clustering methodologies like term weight based hybridized harmonic k-means and coverage factor based hybridized harmonic k-means algorithms. Clustering is normally performed with the help of k-means algorithm, and cluster centroids are optimally found using harmonic search algorithm. We have several challenges in this particular domain. So one such challenge is we could able to notice a reduced accuracy because unrelated documents may also be grouped together. So in order to get rid of this, we have proposed a strategy called novel feature weighting and feature selection based hybrid scheme for document clustering with optimized and unsupervised constraint kernel matrix k-means and harmonic search method. So this will definitely lead to accurate clustering of documents. So this proposed method also optimizes the kernel matrix based on the feature ranges of data set by utilizing particle swarm optimization. So in this paper, we have taken in two different data sets. One is news group, another one is TREC. And the performance metrics that are adopted in this work is precision, recall, F-measure, ADDC, entropy, overall similarity, followed by cluster purity. Introduction. So this clustering comes under the category of data mining. So we all know data mining is a technique that will help us to find the meaningful content from huge volume of data. We have several tasks of data mining: classification, clustering, regression, and association rule mining are notable tasks. So out of which our focus is on clustering. So clustering is the procedure of considering the similarity that exists among the data. So that will help us to divide and form a group. So we have two important factors with respect to cluster. One is intercluster, another one is intracluster. So data items that are present in the same cluster will exhibit higher level of similarity, that we call it as intracluster. The data items that are placed in different clusters will exhibit least level of similarity, so that we call it as intercluster. Then literature survey. So when I have done related work for this paper, I have come across all these terms like weighted k-means, gravitational ensemble clustering, invasive weed optimization algorithm, semi-supervised concept factorization, feature selection method by using PSO algorithm for text clustering, and finally TF-IDF, that is term frequency and inverse document frequency. So none of the methods have promised on the efficient clustering results, better clustering results. So that made us to move on to this proposed methodology. So we have a common hybrid algorithm. So the hybrid algorithm comprises of k-means and harmony search method. So the input will be given as the different set of documents. So from the documents, the feature could be extracted and the number of clusters could be formed. So this is the k-mean and this is the algorithm for harmony search method. Initially, we have to initialize the harmony memory with random solutions. So and then we have to go for assessing the fitness of solution that are present in the harmony memory, and then we have to improvise the harmony memory, and after making such improvisation, we have to update the harmony memory whenever we have got a new solution until we reach the maximum improvisation. So we have to choose one particular solution from the harmony memory which have got best fitness value. So finally, we have to find a cluster centroid for the newly generated solution. So that is what the overview of harmony search method. And when we talk about k-means algorithm, k-means is one of the traditional clustering algorithm. So the data items will be placed as a centroid of each and every cluster. Whenever there is a new data item that have to be placed inside a cluster, the distance between the data item and centroid value will be calculated. So which particular centroid, to reach which particular centroid the value have become, we have got the very lesser value on that particular cluster, the data item could be placed. So the traditional methodologies are term weight based hybrid scheme and coverage factor based hybrid scheme. In term weight based hybrid scheme for document clustering, we use the concept called TF-IDF. So this TF denotes the number of times the distinctive term or feature appears in a document. So in this equation, I have calculated the weightage of a term. So weight of a term could be calculated like TF of I, j log of n by DF of j. Here TF of I, j denotes frequency of feature j in document di. N is the total number of documents that have been taken for the analysis, and DF of j is number of records in which a particular feature appears. So this particular algorithm uses TF of features to cluster the documents. As a result, only low-level cluster could be formed. This TF-IDF model does not consider the words which appear just once or twice in the document. There are certain chances for the words to be used for defining the category of the document. The significance of these words cannot be identified when we take this TF methodology. So that could be one of the setbacks of this scheme. So another one scheme related to this document clustering is coverage factor based hybrid scheme for document clustering. So this denotes the coverage of a feature as the percentage of the files containing the minimum possibility of a particular term. So the coverage factor algorithm have been clearly given in this. And again, the problem is that when we take TF-IDF or when we take coverage factor, the actual importance of the word could be lost. We could not able to cover all the documents. Since because of all these factors, we cannot able to expect a high quality clusters, good results. So we have to make a move on to the proposed method. Proposed method is novel feature weighting and feature selection for hybrid scheme for document clustering. So in this methodology, the parameters include weight, softness, number of clusters of the general kernel function are tuned using PSO in order to improve the discrimination in the higher dimensional space. Thus, the optimized kernel is formed for improving the accuracy of document clustering. Also, in this method, particle swarm optimization is very well used for finding the optimized kernel matrix by identifying optimal weight and membership value of each and every data object. So this have to be done for n number of iterations. In each and every iteration, a particle has a set of kernel matrices which are derived from the data objects along with the updated weight and membership matrix. So the optimized kernels are very much useful for calculating the similarity among the different set of features, heterogeneous features. So the algorithm, the objective function for fine-tuning the parameters of vector p with respect to PSO is given. So d of j comma I comma I denotes the distance between successive ith vector in the jth cluster. Similarly, d of k comma I comma j denotes distance between ith vector and jth cluster in total number of clusters. So the distance between ith vector and the jth cluster with the centroid of qth cluster in the higher dimensional space is also given in this slide. So when we talk about unsupervised constraint kernel matrix k-means, it can be performed by the machine itself. It includes two types of constraints. One is about word constraints, another one is document constraints. So word constraints are mainly depends on word classifications that are learned from corpus, any repository. The mustlings are added if two words are close to each other semantically. Named entity identification, overlapped named entities are used to frame the constraint for all these input documents. In case if we go for document constraints, the mustling constraints are built from the connected entities like person, location, and organization. So results and discussion. So the we could able to observe the proposed NFWFS-HSDC methodology offers a better precision, recall, and F measure. All such performance metrics could give a satisfactory result when we go for this proposed methodology. So from these representation, it is concrete proof that the proposed methodology have outperformed the existing methodologies in terms of getting fine-tuned clusters. So these are all the values that we have obtained from our analysis. In each and every performance metric, we could able to notice that the proposed methodology have got very good results when we compare with the existing two methodologies. So this particular table denotes the values when we take news group data set, and this table denotes the values of TREK data set. So the graphical representation of the analysis is given here. This is about precision, recall, F measure, ABDC, entropy, overall similarity, followed by cluster purity value. Conclusion. So different techniques like term frequency based hybrid scheme and coverage factor based hybrid scheme, novel feature scheme, everything we have implemented. So when we take k-means algorithm, it have got a limitation of generating local optimal solution. So that's what the reason behind taking this hybridized algorithm. Without relying only on k-means algorithm, we have taken this hybridized algorithm since because of this limitation. When we take harmony search method, it will take more time to converge. So when we take one existing methodology like TF-HSDC, the clusters are produced only based on the term frequency count. In case of coverage factor, it won't give any assurance that all the documents are considered for the clustering purpose. So the final point is that this proposed NFWFS-HSDC considers a single viewpoint that could be used to cluster the document. The effectiveness of single viewpoint clustering mainly depends on the appropriateness of the similarity measure. When our focus is on similarity measure, we could obviously get a fine-tuned and good quality clusters. So these are all the references we have taken in order to complete this analysis. Thank you.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. I am Anushree Gaur, and I am here to present my research work, which is named as Media Access Protocol for Wireless Sensor Network Using Active Reception Scheme-Based Energy Efficient Technique. So if basically, this particular paper is based on the RMAC scheme, and this is a time division multiple access-based MAC protocol. And because as we have seen, like, there are data transmission in wireless sensor network, there may be a collision occur, or there's a problem of time delays and all. So the main feature is to conserve energy through limiting traffic overhearing or idle listening or retransmission of data and packet collisions. So this is what uses a distributed scheduling procedure for assigning a time slots for reception called a reception slots to each sensor, and it shares a message of reception slots to each individual nodes. Now, if I'm talking about the result analysis of this particular RMAC, so we have analyzed it with respect to the power consumption or the traffic overhearing and the message delay through detailed simulation environment. And the performance is also analyzed in terms of delays and the power consumptions and all. Okay, so now let's move ahead. So basically, I am going to explain more about my aim or objective, and then we will move to the RMAC description, which is a proper methodology or the system model, and then like how the evaluation will occur, results are for my paper, and at last we will discuss about the references. So this particular paper, if I'm talking about a paper here, so it proposes a reception MAC scheme, which is a time division multiple access based media access control protocol for data transmission in wireless sensor network. So as I have said, like, there may be a problem of collisions or there may be a problem of delays and all. So I have devised a particular scheme, so which is going to give a proper reception slot to each individual receivers and all. And the power of this particular RMAC is to conserve energy through limiting idle listening or traffic overhearing or retransmission of data. So when the retransmission of data is going going to occur whenever there is a problem of like maybe a drop packet or some collision occurs. There can be a retransmission and then the packet collision. So this RMAC is used as a distributed scheduling procedure to assign a time slots. And these sensors who have a data to transmit can consequently wake up in the reception slot of its intended receivers only. So this wireless sensor network actually, if this consists of a small individual sensors that are coordinating among themselves to analyze environmental conditions such as pressure, sound, temperature, vibrations and all. And the sensors and wireless sensor network have a sensing computations and wireless transfer capabilities. And these have emerged as a substitute of a large network infrastructure for a large number of applications in some form of interaction and all. And like designing a MAC scheme, why we have designed this particular MAC scheme for wireless sensor network, it involves many challenges also. So like energy consumption is one of the most vital issue in wireless sensor network, and collision, so which is what we can say, it is a second source of unwanted energy wastage. And overhearing can be the problem over here. So whenever like the traffic load is very high, overhearing can be a serious issue to deploy a network. And the sending and receiving control packets and the control packets overhearing are the source of energy wastage, because control packets are the packets which does not contain any useful information like a proper messages or the bits and all. So let's move ahead now. So the performance of RMAC, as I have said earlier also, like it is going to be analyzed in terms of offered traffic, power consumption, and data delivery delays through detailed simulation, which is like NS2 we have used for simulation purpose. And the performance of this is also analyzed in terms of end-to-end delays, like we have a senders and the receivers and the power consumptions in a multi-hop network and all. And it is going to be compared with some previous protocols, which are SMAC and all. So this is what our RMAC description. So we are going to describe our basic, like we can say a problem statement or proposed work. So RMAC is a time division based multiple access scheme where each sensor is assigned a time slot for reception. That is what are reception slots. And each sensor knows what, like all about the potential receivers. It means the information which are for all the receivers that are all aware about. Now, this reception slot is a time slot during which a sensor node becomes active for receiving data. And the main idea behind this RMAC is like, if a sensor needs to transmit, so the receiving sensor retransmit and it's all the like one hop neighbors from transmitting during ongoing transmission to avoid the collision. And like time synchronization, if we are talking about among the sensors or the node, is the primary requirement of the RMAC scheme, which can be achieved through different proposed schemes. Like we have used the various references over here. Apart from it, if you are talking about the frame structure of this particular RMAC scheme, so these are what the reception slots, like we have divided it into like n number of slots where we have n number of receivers. Now we have reception slot structures also. So this is what 1, 2, 3 up to like n plus 1, n plus 2 and n plus 3, and then we have a data slot. So this is what a delta slot, and then the data slots are there. So frame structure is presented, and we have a like proper frame structures where it adopts the potential frame structures, and each time the frame is divided into n reception slot, and each reception slot is further divided into like delta slots and the data slots and all. So what about this delta slot and data slot? Now I'm going to describe about it. So this delta slot are used for coordination purpose. So basically among neighboring nodes and for the exchange of all the topological information that are needed to perform scheduling of reception slots. On the other hand, slots are reserved for the data reception. This is what the data reception slots are. and the parameter n. So n basically depends on the topology of a network and on like traffic requirements. So delta slot form from n, like here you can see it's from 1 to n, and then these are assigned to the neighboring sensors. And the following, we have a delta slot assignment requirement, like each sensor is assigned a delta slot in all the potential receivers, and each sensor also knows like its delta slot in all its potential receivers. If you are talking about a reception slot, so in this particular reception slot assignment, what happened is after deployment, so you can see this first structure, we have a reception slot only here. And here, if you are going to look at, so this is what here we have a delta slot and data slot. So after deployment and activation, our sensor is to acquire reception slot, and here the new sensors must gather information on the network topology, and these current reception slot assignment from already deployed sensors. So like delta slots n+2, n+3 in each reception slot are reserved from receptions and all, and reception slot assignment completes in 3 steps. So basically, if I'm talking about the steps over here, so just this I will describe now here. Yeah. So steps are like after activation, the newcomer sensor node. Let's say a newcomer enters into topology. So the sensor slot request in n+2, like a delta slot for every reception slot. And the slot request contain a sender reception slot numbers and the delta slot numbers of receivers in the sender. So basically, this particular step one is like the slot request contain null for both senders, like reception slot numbers and the delta slot numbers of the receiver in the sender receiver slot. So here some rules are there. So basically each sensor remains active during all the delta slots of its own reception slots. So it means like every particular sensor, those are in the topology that we are taking into consideration, that have to be remain active. And then secondly is like an available reception slots must not overlap with any reception slots of one hop neighbors. It means like, why I'm saying this thing is like, because it's like the neighbors are going to be overlapped with each other, there may be a problem of collision can occur. So it must not overlap with any of the reception slot of its neighbor. And two, like one hop neighbors cannot have the same reception slot. So like if you are talking about, let's say, one hop neighbor means what? Those are the neighbors, like there's one node, there's another node. So two one hop neighbors cannot have the same reception slot. So next thing is, next particular part here is, like in the following frame, newcomers sends a slot request, which is n+2 at delta slot of each reserved and collide reception slot. If the reception slot is coded collide, then the value of delta slot number of receivers in the sender reception slot and the slot request is set as null. So basically what happened is like each colliding station refrained from transmitting the slot request for a number of frames like we have. So which is like computed as, there's one formula for it. Okay. That is what we are going to use, a random over here. So random is used to calculate the values of I. And this is like, if you are talking about this, like rule number 4, which is a node can send a data request only in its own assigned delta slot and receiver reception slot. Okay. So here, if I am talking about the evaluation of it, so it's the simulation environment, which is like to test the performance of RMAC that we have used. So simulation analysis is conducted in 2 different topologies, which is like the first topology that I have used is a fully connected clusters where each sensor is within the transmission range of all other sensors in the network. And the second type of topology is the tree topology, where traffic going from the leaf sensors to the data sync. Okay, So this is what the structural overview that we can see. This is a force structure. This is a hierarchical structure. Now, so in the paper only, there is one table also, like simulation parameters that we have considered. After that, if you are talking about the result analysis of it, so fully connected cluster topology, we have this figure shows the comparison of between the average delivery delays that are measured for different values of n and the simulation results that shows the average delivery delay that is increases very slowly as the offer traffic is increased. So basically, if you are talking about this figure, so this figure is like it shows the average delivery delay and versus the offer traffic rate. Now, next thing is if you are talking about a power consumption over here, so this figure particularly shows the comparison between the average power consumption for different values of n in fully connected clusters, because firstly we are talking about a fully connected clusters topology, and average power consumption, which is inversely proportional to the value of n. Now next is like this way. This is what the average power consumption. So next thing is like comparison between the previous protocol, which is a SPARMAC. So this is what we have. So multiple values of n we have taken. Okay. So the comparison between the SPARMAC and the RMAC based scheme that we have devised, and average delay versus like achieved throughput in cluster topology. Okay. Now in this figure, in the next figure, we have so tree topology, if we are talking about, so here simulation results are presented for networks where sensors are organized in two level tree topology. There's a leaf sensor that transmits to a data sink and the sensors at level zero also. So this is what we have, two graphs over here. So average consumed power versus achieved throughput at a data sink in a tree topology. And this is what the next is what the average end-to-end delay delivery versus achieved throughput at data sink in tree topology. So basically, if the main summary or the main conclusion of this paper is like energy efficient MAC protocol, that is a MAC media access based scheme protocol, is very necessary because we in the network scenario, if we are talking about collision or multiple, actually works are also have done to prevent collision, but I have added something like to make or more energy efficient, and considering multiple topologies, like how the results we have achieved over here. So this is what an energy efficient MAC scheme, which is proposed for data transmission in wireless sensor network, and it spares energy through like limiting traffics and all, where we have various reception slots and the data slots. So this is what we have our references. So I have referred these papers, multiple papers where I have referred. Thank you everybody for paying attention. Thank you so much.
Myself, I'm Raviteja Kocharla. I'm going to present my paper with the title Efficient Routing Strategy for Energy Management in Wireless Sensor Network. This is my outline presentation. First, I'm going to explain outline of wireless sensor network, then routing protocol system in wireless sensor network, sensor protocol for information via negotiation, and directed diffusion. Next, I'm going to explain minimal cost forwarding algorithm, energy aware routing, leech protocol. After that, I'm going to conclude with the references. This is my basic outline of my presentation. Outline of wireless sensor network. Wireless sensor network refer to a collection of distributed that are used to examine the physical circumstances and coordinate the data at the center location. One of the important aspects of routing protocol is that they should be efficient in the consumption of energy and have a prolonged life for the network. The routing protocol which is efficient in energy consumption is categorized into four main steps. Communication model is the first step, and the second one is a reliable routing, and the third one is topology-based routing, and the last one is network structure. The network structure can be classified as flat or hierarchical. The communication model can be classified as query, coherent or non-coherent negotiation-based routing protocol systems. The topology-based protocol can be classified as mobile or location-based, maybe. So reliable routing can be classified as QoS, quality of services, and multiple path-based routing services. Then already we know that wireless sensor network will play a very important role in many applications of in our daily life. Wireless sensor network plays a critical role in battlefield monitoring and military reconnaissance and tsunami detection, patient health monitoring, disaster surveillance, and crisis management. In so many aspects, wireless sensor networks will play their prominent role. It is having sensor nodes. SN will indicate here sensor node. Sensor node is comprised of, it is having memory, processor, sensing elements, batteries, and transceivers. The sensor data will be sent to base station for further processing. Due to the tiny nature of sensor nodes, it has a few limitations such as memory, bandwidth, processing capability, and battery power. These are the some kind of limitations of the sensor nodes. So this is the outline diagram of the wireless sensor network. We are here, we are having the sensor networks with the processor, storages, and transfer with the internet connections. We are having, this is the whole picture of the wireless sensor network, how it will be distributed, how it will be connected to the internet, how the data we are going to gathering, and how we are going to store the data, what we collected from the sensor. A routing protocol system in wireless sensor network. If the nodes are static table driven or preferred, then the reactive routing protocol, a sufficient level of energy was consumed for locating the route of the nodes and setting of relative routing protocol as well. Cooperative routing is another type of routing protocol, and this protocol, the data are sent to the central node where the data can be combined to the user later for further processes, by which routing cost can be reduced in the concept of usage of energy. A network structure based protocol. Here flat routing is there. Flat routing protocol is also known as multi-hop. All the nodes of this flat protocol will be similar job, and sensor nodes are used for performing the sensing task. The TIN and APTN protocols are motivated to develop this kind of other protocols that lead to the network structure-based protocols. Sensor protocols for information via negotiation. So this protocol uses the data from the nodes, those are nearer to it, and those with similar data. So only data distribution will be the further process in it. The sensor protocols for information via negotiation use the current energy and run the network, and the working process are done with the energy remaining in the system. The working structure of this protocol are based on time-driven pattern and to which the information is distributed to the entire network, even if the information is not needed for the users. The SPIN protocol is designed with the idea of two basic features: sensor nodes, work efficiency, and helps in conserving more energy by sending the data only required by the sensor instead of sending all. This is the important point that we have to highlight it. Sensor nodes, work efficiency, and helps in the conserving more energy by sending the data only required nodes by the sensor instead of sending all. So there is some traditional protocol called the gossiping offloading based. They are the one which uses more energy and more bandwidth is needed while sending data or extract data for the network system. Direct diffusion is another technique I included. That DD is the DC, data-centric paradigm, that all the nodes are named under attribute value. The DC is used for combining different nodes together, which are obtained through different sources by avoiding redundancy, reducing the transmission, through which the energy will be saved and will be prolonged for the lifetime for the running network system. This is the main theme of our paper, is that we need to extend the lifetime of the wireless sensor network. The DC is used for combining different nodes together, which are obtained through different sources by avoiding redundancy, reducing the transmission, through which the energy will be saved and will be prolonged for lifetime for running the network system. So in the DD system, the sensor is capable of measuring events through which information are created with help of neighborhood node. Our base station data are processed by the interest of the broadcasting channel. Interest here is referred to the task needed to be performed by the network. A network spreads over a wider area in the network by hope and later broadcasted to all nodes in the neighborhood. DD in spin varies in two aspects. So the vary between DD and spin is, in DD, the queries in the data are revealed with the request made by base station, where the base station sends all these queries to the nodes by floating the task. In spin, only nodes, those who are interested, can query the data. And the second point is the communication pattern of DD is within neighborhood, with the neighborhood node, which are capable of performing data aggregation and caching. And after that, the minimal cost forwarding algorithm, MCFA. In base station, the message will be broadcasted with zero cost, while the node set it cost to be infinity. In the base station, what it is going to be infinity is the node sets the cost to be infinity. Each node, after receiving the message from base station, will check the estimation cost, whether it is lower to higher than the estimated. First, we need to estimate it, then we need to compare it. Each node, after receiving the message from the base station, will check the estimation cost, whether it is lower to higher than the estimation. If the estimation matches, then the message will be updated in the system. If it is not, it will not be updated. The message updated in the system is known as a recent. If this is not happening, then the process will not move to forward head. This is the only highlighted points we are having. If the estimation is matched, then the message will be updated in the system. That is what the minimal cost forwarding algorithm, MCFA. Next, energy-aware routing. Energy-aware routing protocol or energy-saving protocol, which are utilized for minimizing the energy of the overall system consumed by wireless sensor network. This protocol is further classified as energy servers or energy balancers. This protocol initiates to know the connection between all nodes and sources and the cost required for handling the queries. With the obtained information later, it will be updated in the table. So this protocol is further classified as the energy saves or energy balances. This protocol initiates to know the connection between all the nodes and sources and the cost required for handling the queries. With the obtained information later, it will be updated in the table. The path which requires high cost are removed from this routing table, and the present table is forwarded with neighborhood nodes which are proportional to the current cost. So this is the protocol is further classified as the energy savers or energy balancers. This protocol initiates to know the connection between all the nodes and sources and the cost required for handling the queries. With the obtained information later, it will be updated in the table. The path which requires high cost or removed from this routing table, and the present table is forwarded with neighborhood nodes which are proportional to the current cost. So low energy adapt to clustering hierarchy, LEAC protocols, we know that it is a clustering based protocol where distributive clustering formation is also included in the system. It selects the nodes as CH randomly, and the role of CH will be rotated in order to reduce energy loading among the sensors in the networking system. In this LEAC protocol, the nodes arriving from other data nodes and the CH nodes all together send packets to the base station, by which the number of messages transmitted to the base station will be reduced. LEAC utilizes time division multiplex access, multiple access TDMA, for CDMA, media access control protocol, for purpose of reducing collisions. The collision of the data in this protocol happen with on the basis of centralized system, and it is happened a period of time basis. That is the reason why the LEAC protocol, the nodes arrived from other data node and the CH nodes all together send packets to the base station, by which the number of messages transmitted to the base station will be reduced. This is what the LEAC protocol, low energy adaptive clustering hierarchy. Here the conclusion is that the routing process, what we are discussing now, the routing process in the wireless sensor network is typically the new research concept which are highly preferred nowadays. In this paper, an effective routing technique have been explained with a reference to the wireless sensor network, which are capable of having network with a prolonged lifetime. It means that whenever we are trying to use this kind of algorithm, so that the energy will be optimized, the energy will be used in an effective manner, so that the lifetime of the network is going to be extended. Once the lifetime of the network is extended, then we can achieve our goal with the low cost sensor power networks. So the routing process in wireless sensor network is typically the new research concepts which are highly preferred nowadays. In this paper, an effective routing technique have been explained with the reference to the wireless sensor network, which are capable for having a network with prolonged lifetime. So these are the references I used in my paper. So mostly I use the references, very recent references, and with the I took this kind of paper from good journals. So one paper is from the year 2020, 2017, 2019. I took so many papers and referred to complete this work. So thank you very much.
Warm greetings to all. It's a great honor and privilege to propose a vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me first of all start by giving a glory to the Almighty God for making our international conference BDCC 2020 in new normal. First and foremost, I thank our special guest, Professor John Lee, a Department of Computer Science, School of Computing and Engineering, University of Huddersfield, UK, who have given a wonderful talk on smart application. The next chief guest, the second keynote speaker, Dr. Manik Sharma, the Department of Computer Science and Application from the University of DAV, India, have given a wonderful technical talk. And next, on behalf of our BDCC family, I would like to take this opportunity to express our hearty thanks to our conference manager, Ms. Carolina, who has guided us and operated us from thousands of miles in cyber mode. Next, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for our general chair, Dr. Ananda Kumar, who worked in all 3D directions to make this conference as a great success. And I also want to wish and express my gratitude to many subcommittee members in this conference. One subcommittee member is web chair Professor K. Karthikeyan, who worked related to the cyber committee. And next, I want to wish the publicity and social media chair Dr. B. S. Akshaya from Sri Ishwar College of Engineering, who took our conference in virtual mode. Next, I would wish the workshop chair, Dr. K. Aravindan, who worked in a committee member. And next, I would like to wish the publication chair, Professor M. Surya, and also the local chair, Professor K. Sivakumar. And finally, I would like to thank all the distinguished invitees for this conference. Thank you.